Hello, good morning everybody. Today my topic is gait disorders in clinical practice of neurology. I always believe that whenever you approach any disorder in clinical practice, you must have some basic understanding about the neuroanatomical substrates and physiology related to that disorder. So the basic prerequisite for upright bipedal gait are, you must have good anti-gravity support of the body so that you can maintain an upright bipedal posture from squatting or lying down position. Next step is stepping, that involves touching the sole on the ground and shifting the center of gravity. And the third issue is maintenance of equilibrium, because when a person walks, there is continuous shifting of the center of gravity. And the fourth and last important issue is propulsion, that involves both forward movement as well as alternate lateral movements of the trunk. So these are the basic requisites to have normal upright bipedal gait. I am not going into details of gait cycle, but you must know that a gait cycle starts with one heel strike and it ends with striking of the heel of that side. And there are two phases in the gait cycle. One is the stance phase, that is the phase when there is acceptance of body weight on the surface. And the other is the swing phase, when there is limb progression and foot clearance. In the stance phase, that comprises about 40% of the gait cycle, the main muscles involved are anti-gravity muscles, that is the extensors of hip, knee, and plantiflexors of ankle. And during the swing phase, the main muscles involved are flexor muscles, that is the flexors of hip, knee, and dorsiflexors of the ankle. When you approach a gait disorder, you must be acquainted with some terms related to gait. First is cadence, that is the number of steps per unit time. Next is step length, that is the distance between successive heel strides of the lower limbs. And stride length is the distance between successive heel strike of the same limb. That is, step length is almost double the stride length. And step height means vertical clearance of the foot from the floor during swing. And base is the distance between the medial malleoli of both feet during standing and walking. So whenever in neurology or in clinical medicine, you describe any gait disorder, you have to describe it in terms of cadence, step length, step height, and width of the base. Now let's have some very overview idea about anatomical substrates of normal gait. To have normal gait, the efferent systems involved are pyramidal tract, which ultimately reaches the spinal cord, and it ultimately executes its function via the peripheral nerves, neuromuscular junction, and muscle. And the sensory inputs that were required are proprioceptive impulses from the limbs, visual cue, and vestibular input. And these apparent and efferent impulses should have a very good integration at the level of frontal cortex, basal ganglia, brainstem, and cerebellum. So, if there is any gait disorder, there is probably problem in any of these anatomical substrates, or there may be combination of anatomical substrates may be involved. To make it very simple, if we have to have normal gait, that involves three types of counselor. One is activation and guidance of GATE, next regulation of GATE, and ultimate execution of that GATE. Activation and guidance part is mediated by cortex. Regulation part is maintained by basal ganglia cerebellum, and ultimate the executory part is maintained by the brainstem and spinal cord. If I go into further little bit details, when we consider the activation and guidance part, basically the guidance part is done by the visual cortex, that is the occipital cortex, which gives an idea about the surrounding environment. It then projects to posterior parietal cortex, which makes a map of the surrounding environment. And ultimately that reaches primary motor cortex and premotor cortex, particularly supplementary motor cortex, which maintain the muscle tone during the gait. So gait initiation occurs at the level of cerebral cortex, and the parts involved are occipital cortex, posterior parietal cortex, and frontal cortex. But limbic cortex also has a tremendous role so far as the consider emotional activation of GATE. Now, regarding the control part, there is a reciprocal connection between basal ganglia and cerebral cortex, which maintains the amplitude and speed of the movement. Projections from the basal ganglia goes to the brainstem. In the brainstem, there are two centers. One is midbrain locomotor region, and another is pedunculopontine nucleus. The projection from basal ganglia to MLR, that determines the rhythm of the gait. And the projection from the basal ganglia to PPN maintains the postural tone of the muscles. And ultimately, the impulses project to the spinal cord, and the spinal cord fires interneurons and motor neurons execute the gait. But you must remember that in the subhumans, spinal cord is the central pattern generator. In humans also, it is the central pattern generator, but it is always under the influence of the supranuclear pathways. And another important part in this whole control system is the cerebellum, which gets information from the vestibular apparatus, from the limbs via proprioceptive input, and also from the cerebral cortex. And cerebellum also sends its efferent projection to the cerebral cortex, basal ganglia, vestibular system, and as well as to the spinal cord. So there is a complex interaction between all these anatomical substrates to produce a normal bipedal gait. Now, in actual clinical practice, when you approach a gait disorder, you have to have a very good history so far as whether there is any history of fall, any difficulty in going upstairs or downstairs, any diurnal variation, any claudication, any tripping. And during examination, you must do a good musculoskeletal examination as well as examination of the nervous system, including assessment of the cognitive function. Now, in examination of gait proper, you should analyze it in a very systematic fashion. First, start with posture of the trunk. Next, you just assess how the person is getting up from sitting posture. Then, when the person stands, what is the wide base? Next, whether there is any start hesitancy. Next part, what is the step length? What is the stride length, step height? And what are the number of steps per minute? And lastly, you look for associated arm swing, whether there is any fascination and whether there is any difficulty in turning. So if you look at all these points, practically you are covering all aspects of gait, and careful examination can tell you what is the problem. Now let's come one by one. First, start with basically gait disorders. Maybe a high level gait disorder, it may be a middle level gait disorder, it may be a lower level gait disorder. By high level gait disorder, I mean there is interruption of interaction between the cognitive and motor system. So if you just remember what I have told few minutes back, if there is any cerebral lesion and there is interruption of interaction between cognitive and motor system, as it happens in a patient of dementia, people Alzheimer, vascular or frontotemporal dementia, or in any patient of normal pressure hypoglobulinemia, the characteristic gait is start hesitancy or gait ignition failure. That the person has difficulty in initiating gait. It is also called magnetic gait, as if the foot is glued to the ground. Speed is slow, steps are short, and step height is also decreased, leading to shuffling while walking. And the cadence, the number of steps per minute is also less. And there is increased percentage of time in double support. The base is usually wide, and there is a tendency to recurrent fall. So the most characteristic point in this case is start hesitancy and short steps and lower cadence and recurrent tendency to fall. The next disorder is middle level disorder. At the middle level, there may be problem in the pyramidal tract, extrapyramidal tract, or in the cerebellum. If it is a problem of the pyramidal tract, that is, if a patient has heavy paresis or paraparesis, again the cadence is low, speed is slow, steps are short, and the patient has circumduction. And if there is bilateral pyramidal tract involvement, there is seizuring of gait. So common clinical situation that we occur this type of gait is in a case of stroke or following acute transverse myelitis. So these are the characteristics of pyramidal gait due to pyramidal tract involvement. Next example of middle level gait disorder is due to involvement of the basal ganglia. In this situation, the speed is slow, steps are short, there is poor foot clearance during swing, leading to shuffling, base wide, difficulty in turning, the person turns in block, and there is greater gait impairment during 12 tacks. There is decreased arm swing during walking, and there is also increased risk of fall. In the common clinical situation where we encounter this type of gait is in idiopathic Parkinson's disease, Parkinson's plus syndrome, multiple system atrophy like this. In extrapyramidal gait disorder, there may be also some hyperkinetic movement disorder. And in those situations, the gait is characterized by a bizarre gait, striatal toe, that is persistent hyperextension of the great toe. And abnormalities may increase during walking, and there may be associated grimacing of face and repetitive tongue movement. In cerebellar disorder, it is also another example of middle level gait disorder. There is irregular cadence with variable step length, wide base, unsteadiness increases during turning, and tandem gait becomes very difficult. Now let us come to the lower level gait disorder. Lower level gait disorder may occur because of the involvement of the peripheral nerve or muscle or myoclonal junction. In case of peripheral neuropathy, if there is sensory ataxia, the base is wide and there is greater postural instability with the eyes closed, and there is increased step height. This is called stiffened gait. And there is foot slap at the beginning of the stand phase. Patient tends to look at their feet while talking. So if you get high stiffened gait, thumping gait, diurnal variation, that is increased disability during night, you think of a lower level gait disorder due to sensory ataxia, due to large fiber peripheral neuropathy, or due to posterior column involvement. It may also happen sometimes due to vestibular deficit and visual defect. But it vestibulopathy, the most characteristic feature of associated characteristic feature are vestibular symptoms like vertigo, nausea, vomiting. And there is no appendicular ataxia as it happens in case of cerebellar disorder. And another example of lower limbic gait disorder is waddling gait that occurs due to hip abductor weakness. Common clinical scenario where we get is muscular dystrophy, polymyositis. In those situations, there is lordotic posture, hyperextension of the knee during stance, and there is waddling gait. And the last part of the lower motor involvement is the muscle and joint involvement, where there is antalgic gait, where the stance phase becomes shorter, stride length is short, and there is reduced range of motion in affected joints. And we must not forget psychogenic gait, where there is bizarre, inconsistent gait with any with lack of any effort, and there is repeated knee buckling without actual fall or self-injury. Now, this slide I have prepared for postgraduates. Basically, after hearing so many things, sometimes they get confused when they actually are going to describe a gait disorder. But you always remember that whatever gait disorder you get, in most of the situations, either it may be a high-level gait disorder, that is interruption of the connections between the higher centers and the gait executing center in the brain, or it may be a spastic pyramidal tract, extrapyramidal, cerebellar, or sensory ataxia. So most of the cases, it falls in either of the five groups. And when you describe it, you first try to elicit whether there is any gait initiation problem that occurs in high-level gait disorder that does not happen in other types. And what is the step length? In high-level disorder, spastic and extrapyramidal, step length is short. In sensory ataxia, its step length is short. But in cerebellar ataxia, it is variable. Next is step height. Step height is again short in case of high-level disorder, spastic and extrapyramidal disorder. In cerebellar, it is variable. And in sensory ataxia, it is high stepped gait. Cadence is regular in most of the situations, but in cerebellar disorder, it is irregular cadence. And base is wide if there is cerebellar ataxia, sensory ataxia, and also in spastic ataxia, the base becomes wide. In others, the base is usually narrow. And you also try to find out other specific findings related to that gait disorder. Like in high-level gait disorder, there is magnetic gait. In spastic gait disorder, there is circumduction and scissoring. In extrapyramidal disorder, there is decreased arm swing, festination, freezing, and the patient turns in block. In cerebellar disorder, tandem gait is impaired. In sensory ataxia, there is high stepped thumping gait. Why thumping? Because the patient puts the foot on the ground with a thumping pattern to get a sound so that he knows that his foot is in the proper position. So if you, at the end, if you remember all these points and try to describe a gait disorder, I hope you can reasonably make a diagnosis and also pinpoint the specific anatomical substrates involved in particular gait disorder. Thank you.